Hello everyone. Yeah, welcome back to Post Tales webinars. So today, again, Nisha is not with me. She is traveling to Canada from Mara today. Like, she already boarded her flight. And we have an excellent photographer as guest today. Mr. Girish Gowda from Bangalore, who is a very good photographer, a very good macro photographer. And he was a former HR professional, and he's currently working as a naturalist and a macro photography guide based in Agumbe Rainforest in South India. And let's welcome Girish to the show, and let's ask him more about himself. Hello, Girish.
Hi, Hermes.
Hi, welcome to the Postales webinar.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for accepting our request and share your experience here.
Yeah,
let's start with how you entered into photography and how you selected this genre of macro photography.
Okay, so yeah. Me entering into photography was a fluke. I mean, I never had a idea or any interest in photography prior to I came to Bangalore. I am from a small city called Mandya, which is 100 kilometers from Bangalore. So I did my studies there. I came to Bangalore like everybody else, looking for a job. So I found one. I was working there. I found few people, colleagues of mine, who were interested into photography.
Okay.
Interested into going into harping and stuff. So I joined along 2-3 trips, and that thing caught me in. And gradually I got a camera from a friend of mine, and started photographing. Initially I started with snakes and frogs. So that was my first interest. So it still is. But recently I'm exploring the wide world of insects. So that's how I started. So gradually I got into snakes and frogs, got introduced to few like-minded people, got more interested into it, started to explore equipments. When I say explore, I used to borrow equipments from a few of my friends and go around photographing whatever I could find at that time. And we used to spend a lot of time in the jungle, like without any prior plan, go there, go to a random place, look for things around. So that's how all the interest started. And as and when you get into it, you get to meet people, and gradually it led me to different paths altogether. I met a good friend of mine, Shashank, who runs a homestay called Ingara. So I got into there as a naturalist, like a part-time. I used to go there in the weekends and during monsoons and stuff, and gradually started losing interest in the IT job, whatever I was doing back here. So then he offered me a job full-time as a naturalist there, so then I shifted. It's almost 3 years back, and it's going good until the COVID came. For now I'm in Bangalore and in my native most of the time. So probably hopefully things get better, and I'll go back by this monsoon exploring more things.
That's great. Yeah, so let's begin with the photographs. A lot of people are waiting to see your amazing work.
So today I'll just be sharing a few of the photographs, random things, and whatever photos I liked, and I will not keep it long. I'll stick to the 30 minutes mark, hopefully. And in between, I'll try to tell how I photographed it and other things. So I'll hope my screen is been shared. So I'll start with my favorites, frogs and toads. So this one, it's called a Malabar tree toad. It's one of the only tree dwelling toad in India, and it's endangered right of now. And very less is known about it. So there is a lot of work happening around this thing, and citizens are helping shape up and understand the species better right now. So This is a very tiny frog. It should be hardly half an inch. This is a froglet. So we found two, three of them when there was a flooding in a nearby pond. They were on top of the small shrub there. So I photographed it in wherever I found it. So these are pretty interesting. A lot of people come in search of these toads. So not that regularly seen. So macro photography, when I say, like, I would like to tell you, like, what exact equipment I use. I am a Nikon user. I use a Nikon 5100,
okay,
and a flash of Yongnuo, and I built my own diffuser. So diffusion of light is the most important thing for somebody to photograph, and the lens you use. Of course, if you want some sharp images, you need to have a macro lens for it. Body, I don't think so matters much until unless you are going to get them printed and stuff. With the external light, you can pretty much get good pictures if you have a good lens. So I use a Tamron 90mm macro lens. I use a 5100 Nikon old body, and I have an external flash with a diffusion built to it. So that's pretty much my equipment. And for super close-ups, I use something called Reynox DCR 250. Mm-hmm. It's a tiny clip-on magnifying lens. Most of the macro photographers would know about it. So that will give you more than almost two times magnification.
Okay.
So this is a pair of pseudophyllitis, we like to call. Some call it Wayanad, but it's not sure what exactly it is. So in frogs, usually females are the bigger ones and males are the smaller one. There is nothing called actual mating when it comes to frogs. It's more of amplexes, what we call them, where the female carries the male to a suitable nesting place, and she lays the eggs, and the male does the external fertilization. So the male clings on to the female, and female is responsible to find a good nesting place. So this is all during monsoon. Monsoon is one season when everything starts getting into life. So if you go right now during peak summers to Agumbe, for example, so there won't be much activity when it comes to amphibians or any other critters. Definitely would see spiders, and you will see some insects and all active right now. But monsoon is one season when everything explodes. So frogs come out to mate and reproduce. Snakes come in search of them. And that whole cycle continues. So you will get to see a lot of activities during monsoon. Having said that, it's a challenge photographing in monsoon. So it's pretty wet, as you know. Once your equipments get wet, you get all sort of trouble like fungus and other things. So you need to keep that in mind. I do is, like, I use a plastic cover wrapped around my camera at times, or else when I'm with guests, when I take them out for photography, I don't carry my camera. So most of the time it is somehow secured. But at times, if you have to photograph, I do. Sometimes it gets wet. I have a dry box back in the place where I stay. So I go and keep it dry for the whole night. If in case somebody doesn't have a dry cabinet, I would suggest you carry a silica gel, a pack of them, keep them in your bag, seal the camera in your bag and keep it overnight so that it can suck up some moisture in it. There is nothing worse than getting your equipment wet and it doesn't work for the remaining days you are going to stay, and you had planned to photograph stuff. So taking care of equipments is one thing during monsoon. So it's pretty challenging to photograph them at that time. And you need some help. At least you need to have friends around who can help you out, holding umbrellas or giving some focus assist lights and other things. This is one such situation where it was pouring heavily and I was able to photograph it. You can clearly see here, these are all the eggs what the female is carrying. So she will find some shrub which is dense, or some moss, where she will go and lay the eggs, and the male will fertilize it later. So these are the eggs of a bush frog. It's a different species of bush frog. It's called a Kudremukha bush frog. So this is how they lay their eggs. This is a moss, and they go inside, and the female lays the eggs, and as I told, the male fertilizes it. And bush frogs, the speciality in them is they come out fully developed as a froglet, unlike other frogs. So other frogs, if you in our schools, why they are called amphibian is like they have this theory of them having two stages of life, one in water and one terrestrial. So these bush frogs have evolved completely. So what you are seeing here is almost developed froglets of a bush frog. So what they do is they develop completely as a froglet, unlike other frogs where they get they develop as a tadpole and come out of the egg, swim in the water and gradually develop into a froglet. So this doesn't happen in bush frogs. So all the bush frogs found in Agumbe, at least, they do develop directly like this. Very less is known about frogs, pretty much like their life cycle. It varies, like some might have done research related to certain things, and a different species might breed in a different manner altogether. So we happen to see healthy number of egg clutches around this particular spot where we regularly go. And this one was shot with the help of a torch light from the backside and a diffused front light. So what happens is like this top of the eggs are all pretty shiny. So the angle of the light matters a lot. So this one is not a direct light. So the flash was given from the side, and the torch light was also not directional towards the lens. It was on the other side so that you can avoid glare from the egg. And this is what I caught.
Okay.
One more of the same thing. This is a froglet get developed. This is the top of the clutch where I was able to somehow manage to get a photo of this. This is a Pseudophyllatus frog, and what you see here is a beetle grub. These are Ipomis beetle, they call it. So what they do is like the larva of the beetle clings on to the amphibians, whatever amphibians they can find, and get stuck under their throat, and gradually they are more like a parasite. So they gradually suck into the juices of this froglet. This is a froglet, this is a tiny froglet which was not even an inch long. And what it does is like it sucks the juice out of the froglet and starts developing, and gradually at some point of time it will kill the froglet. It's very difficult for the froglet to get rid of it because they are like very tightly onto that thing, and once they are almost developed and ready to the next level of their life stages, until then they will be clinging onto it. And this is a very painful thing to the froglet. Probably it won't survive much time. So that's how raw nature is. So I have only seen this once, but there are plenty of records across from the world, and they have quite a few studies happening onto this beetle grub, whatever, and their life stages. This is another bush frog we find there. It's called the Coorg yellow bush frog. So this one, I had to wait for like at least 20 minutes for it to call. So this is a male frog which is calling out for a female. So only males call in frogs, so females don't. So the frogs, when they're calling, and if they have any other frogs of the same species in front of them, they are very aggressive. So when they are at their peak of the call, they don't bother much until unless there are not many people around. So this I shot when I was with one more of my guests, that's it, so two of us, and I just kept my camera on top of it, and even when it stopped calling, I kept the camera there only to avoid the movement and to avoid it being disturbed. So I spent around 10 minutes standing there, and gradually it started calling. It couldn't resist the call of the opposite male, so started calling. I clicked 2-3 images of it, and one turned out to be this. This is one of my favorite images till date. So that's what it is about. And this is the other bush frog, rarely seen. I've seen it once. It's called a water droplet bush frog. These are high elevation frogs. So when I say high elevation, these are treetop frogs. Like, they always stay on top of the trees. And the reason why they are called as a water droplet frog is because their call mimics exactly like the way a water is dropping. So, and it's pretty loud. These are small bush frogs. These are hardly 2 inches long, but the amount of sound they make is like tremendous. So treetops, you can, in the monsoon, peak monsoon, you will definitely hear them, but very rarely seen. So all these droplets you see are all rain. And okay. Usually what I do is like, this is shot without any Raynox or anything. So my usual settings for something, a subject as big as this, would be somewhere around, aperture will be somewhere around 8 to 13 maximum. I don't go beyond that. And my flash power with diffusion will be somewhere around 1/8. That depends again on the situation. And since I use a lower model of Nikon, there is a possibility of noise being introduced when you go beyond ISO 200 or anything. So I make sure I always keep the ISO low and I play with the light. So I give more light if in case required. And shutter speed somewhere around 1/160, 1/200 max, nothing beyond that. So that's my usual setting. And aperture varies depending on the size of the subject. I don't go beyond f16 because if you go beyond that, my equipment has like it creates diffraction, the images get softer. So I try to shoot from the maximum focusing distance and then crop the images so that I get a lot of depth in the photos. So that's one more trick what I use to, I mean, most of them use to get more details in the photograph, especially if you're using Raynox or anything as such. So this was shot in F13, ISO 100, and shutter speed is 1/160.
Okay.
So that's it for frogs and insects now. This is an assassin bug. They're very ferocious insects when they hunt. So here it has hunted down a caterpillar, and they don't have mouth parts like other creatures. They have a proboscis which is more like a straw. What they do is like they inject it into the prey. They secrete juice into it, which dissolves the tissues inside, and they suck the whole juice back into themselves. And once they do that, they will just throw down the caterpillar and they will rest for a few days and look for more insects.
Okay.
So this again is a tiny one. So most of the insects photographs, what I'm going to see is show is not beyond an inch or anything as such. So they're almost tiny. And this one I shot with Raynox, that adapter I was talking about. So I try to keep my focus on the eyes. I make sure I zoom into the pictures every time I click a picture. Eyes in focus. And if in case there is any action happening and there is more I want to be in focus, then that depends on the situation. I move my camera and I make sure my plane of focus is changed accordingly.
Okay.
So this is a bagworm. This is a caterpillar inside, which cuts down a small twigs and starts building. So this smaller part is when it will be tiny, and gradually when it grows, it starts building, putting big twigs underneath. And when the time comes, they will become a moth and fly away. So you get to see a lot of this in different varieties. So this is one more variety of it. This is a leaf which has been rolled into, which looks like a witch hat. So and then you find different varieties of them. I guess I have one photo of it. I'll show this one. So these are different things. So this is a piece of leaf what it has covered. This is a piece of leaf which I mean big pieces of leaf. These are dry twigs. This is from a moss. It has built a bag in the moss. This is from other grass matter. This is from a lichen. So bagworms come in different varieties. There are so many varieties. I mean, every time I go out, I find something or the other very different to what I've seen previously. And I've been photographing from almost 2012, I guess. So it's been almost 9+ years now. So I've seen quite a few, and there is still a lot to see. So these kind of things. So, and this is an oak leaf butterfly. So from outside it might look bland and like a leaf, but when it opens the wing, it's bright blue and orange and grayish color inside. So this one I shot with a 90mm macro again. This was quite far. I just cropped it to my need and reframed however I wanted it to. So this mimic exactly like a dry twig. So they will have one stick kind of a thing protruding from the back, and they always sit facing down so that from far it looks like a dry leaf.
Okay.
This again is a close-up of a moth. So butterflies and moths, usually generally when you see them from far, it looks very colorful, very shiny and stuff. So if in case you remember in your childhood when you catch hold of a butterfly or a moth, you will always see a powdery substance stuck to your hand. So these are the scales which are on the thing. So this I've shot with the 90mm and a Raynox. This is almost 2+ magnification. So I wanted to show the scales on this. So all the moths, all the butterflies will have scales like this. Color varies. And most of the time, some of the butterflies and moths color during the day, if in case you see in the cases of butterfly, they will shine according to the light passing through them. So you might see very different colors of things. So those scales will be more brighter, more vivid and more shinier than moths. Moths are usually not that great colorful compared to butterflies. But having said that, there are tiny moths which are like too colorful comparatively. And there are plenty of thousands of species across. So it's like a never-ending thing to photograph moths.
So we have a question from Dr. K.M. Anand. Do you use manual or auto? And so, do you use a tripod for insect and wasp? Or do you always use a Raynox?
See, Raynox depends. See, for the case like this, I definitely use Raynox. And gradually what has happened, I used to shoot only with the macro lens. Now I have started exploring deeper and going closer into the subjects and shooting. So most of the time I use Raynox, and I don't use tripod. All my shots are handheld because I will be walking around. So some of the subjects are like hit and go. Like if in case you are able to shoot at that time, you're done. And most of the time there won't be much time for you to change the setting and get it accordingly. So I always go with some general setting where I use flash mainly for everything, even in daylight. Very less I use ambient light and then fill with flash and stuff. Most of the time will be flash, so my setting remains constant. The only thing I change my setting is how close I am, how far I am, and how tiny the subject is. If it is tinier, I'll increase my aperture. If I am far, I will increase my decrease the aperture and increase my flash intensity. And I don't use manual. I use the latest version of Tamron now. The autofocus in it is quite good, and I shoot in automatic. I mean automatic focus. So I've got used to it. There are people who shoot in manual. Both of them will need some getting used to. So it's not easy. Like in today's cameras, especially Micro Four Thirds, the autofocus is like super fast. So you don't have to switch to manual at all. So they are quite good at focusing into the subject even with dull light. My camera do struggle in dull light. It needs some good ambient light to focus onto it. So that depends on what kind of
And what about the camera mode? Is it
it's manual all the time. Macro, I would suggest everybody to use manual mode. And I see most of the bird and mammal photographers using the rear view autofocus button.
Yeah.
So I usually suggest them not to, and go to your front button for autofocus, as because See, macro at times you might have to use one single hand to hold your camera and hold some subject, what it is sitting on or a plant or anything in the other hand. So you will lose out a major grip of this thumb when you are using a rear view autofocus. So if in case you have grip in these three fingers and you press and hold on to the camera and you use this finger, you will have quite a good grip, and shutter speed anywhere around 160, 1 by 160 to 1 by 200 should be enough for 90, 100, 105mm lenses. So it is just getting used to. Autofocus works very well. So I would suggest anybody to quit tripod if in case there are times people would use tripod if in case they want to have some ambient light in the picture and don't want to shoot it with flash and the light is very dull. They might turn down their shutter speed and shoot with the tripod.
So you're saying avoiding tripod doesn't affect the sharpness?
Not at all. I don't use, many of my macro friends don't use. Okay. So I would still suggest go with, because you will have a lot of opportunity to photograph a lot of things. With tripod, it's not possible at times. Most of the times, especially the place where I stay, Agumbe and all, it's quite dense and the floor will not be even for you to set up. Every time you have to set up tripod, it takes up time. By then, subject might have flew away or ran away. So it's very difficult. So that's it with butterflies. Some insects now. So this is a wood cricket, giant wood cricket, what we call, this is a nymph of it. And this has hunted down, when we saw this, it had already been eating a forest lizard, a juvenile forest lizard. So this is not a normal instance to see some cricket hunting down a reptile and feeding on it. These are quite big, these crickets. And I was surprised, I have never seen anything like that. This thing was like chewing onto it for like at least 20 minutes, and except the head, I think it chewed up all the body and made a lump of it and threw it away and went. These are an interesting creature called planarians. These are terrestrial planarians. They look quite like earthworms, but they're not earthworms. These rest on the leaf. You see them more during monsoons. They come in different varieties. Most of them call it flatworms. So all this hammerhead worm and other flatworms which we see on the tree where the moss is and where it is very moist. So these are the ones which you see. Very less known about them. And this one, I found it resting on a leaf during a night. It was raining heavily. So their shelter is under the leaf or in between the leaf and stuff. So very interesting thing about them is, like, if you cut them in half at a particular order, so those two different parts of the body will turn out to be different individuals altogether. They have that capacity to regenerate their body completely. So very interesting creature. This is a thread-based wasp. I photographed almost like 3 years back. This was in the night. It was resting on a stick at the end. So again, the light, even light is possible just with the diffused light. So I would suggest anybody getting into macro, especially with a macro lens or anything, I would suggest you always build something of your own. A plain white foam sheet would do to start with. Any soft light means the shadows will be softer and there will be no hot spots on the shinier subjects. So you will have, you pretty much will have good color and good balance of the light across, and you will end up getting some amazing results. If in case somebody is not using a diffuser, I would suggest them to try. If you don't find anything, go to a stationery shop, get a foam sheet, small foam sheet, build something. I'll just show. So this was my first diffuser. So this is just a white file sheet, transparent file. I put a small foam sheet on it, and I used to shoot with inbuilt flash. A lot of my images, especially during monsoon, because this setup is very easy to carry inside your jacket, rainproof jacket. So I just tuck it inside. I don't carry any bags. So whenever I need to photograph, this thing is waterproof, the diffuser. So I'll carry it in my hand. I find anything, use the inbuilt flash. At times, inbuilt flash is more than enough to shoot, but external flash, that's a different output altogether. I would suggest you use external. My case is different. I take guests out to, and I show them stuff. I help them photograph, so I spend less time photographing. So I just keep it in case if I find something interesting. And this is my instant setup to shoot something. Or else I have a proper diffuser. This is a huge one. It comes on. It sits on a flash. Comes with a internal LED. So the LED helps to shoot during the night. And this pretty much is the full setup of mine, what I use. So this is a water strider. So it's feeding on an ant. So water striders, I think most of them would have seen. If you go to Western Ghats or any place where the water is clean, you will see a long insect walking on the water. So these are the ones. They have like six pair of legs. They use the first pair and the last pair to float on the water, and the center pair to navigate around. So this one was feeding on an ant, and again, like assassin bug, they have something called proboscis, from which they inject a saliva or a juice kind of a thing, which will dissolve the tissues inside and suck that back inside. This ant, it's called a Jerdon's jumping ant. One of the famous ants in the pet trade industry. These are not common. This is a long one, like more than an inch long, and very restless. I must have taken close to 50 images to get one or two images maximum. So they are very skittish, and they keep roaming around, and they just go around wherever they want to. So very interesting ones. They live in small colonies of 30, 40, and you don't get to see them regularly. The reason why they're called jumping ants is because they jump around like jumping spiders do. So they leap onto the prey or whatever they're feeding. This one's a grass mantis. This is the brown colored one. So the whole body looks like a grass blade. So this is just a close-up of the same thing. What you see, the two black spots, what you see are like pseudo pupils, we call it. They are not actually the pupil. Each bits what you are seeing here on the eyes are like eyes of our own. They're all receptors. They see world in a different manner. So all that thing focused into one, from different angles you get to see different spots. So they're not actually pupil moving in. They are just like optical illusion for us. This is a horsefly, a huge one. So this is a single shot. I don't do stacking, so most of my images, whatever you are seeing today, are all single shot. I have started exploring, but my camera doesn't have a high speed shutter, so no, it hardly shoots 2.53 frames per second. So very difficult to do stacking with that. So most of my images are like single shot. So what I do is like I focus as back as I can, especially when I'm using Raynox. I don't go close to the subject. I don't shoot subjects very close, because the depth of field becomes very shallow. Say for example, I go close to this subject, I would only have this eye in focus, and all the backside of the mouth and underneath, I would have gone out of focus. So what I did is like I came back, I focused on the eye, but as and when you do it and as and when you come back, your depth of field also increases. So while uploading, what I do is I crop it accordingly very close, so that it looks like there is a lot of depth of field involved in a single image. This
So
again, I have
you don't use stacking
no,
code.
I don't do stacking. I've started to explore it, very tedious, like you have to shoot, then come back, process.
Yeah.
And I have clicked 3-4 of them successfully till date. That's it. I've
Okay.
recently started exploring it, but these are all my old images, so none of
Yeah.
these are stacked.
Okay.
So as I told, like these are each bit of them are like the eyes of ours. So each of them receive and perceive colors in different ways. There are so
Okay.
many colors which they see beyond what we can see, and that's why flies and other stuff have very fast response time. It's almost 10 times faster than us. You might be trying to hit them, you won't be able to catch them because the way they see the world is totally different. And this is almost this 360 degree vision. And I read in some paper like dragonflies will have somewhere close to 30,000 bits like this in their eyes, to both eyes combined. So imagine so much of information getting in from so much of different receptors, and they process the world in a different way which we might not be able to completely understand. This is again a lanternfly bug. It's called a Kalidasa. That's the genus name of it. This is a tiny one. I have just gotten too close to it. So this is why they are called lanternflies. As and when they grow, they will have a long snout kind of a thing. Nothing to do with lantern. They don't glow or anything as such. It's just their thing where they use that to dig into the trees, bark, to suck in the sap.
Okay.
So this should be like half an inch probably, and they are very like they just jump off. They're hoppers, so they like hop at a time. They might hop close to 400 times their body length. So you need definitely need patience and probably some luck. It should be seated in an open perch for you to go close and shoot them. This is a cicada. Cicadas, I recently photographed when I was standing under a tree in the night, and I was photographing some other insects, and all of a sudden a shower of water kept on falling on me drop by drop. I used to look up, then continue shooting, and after some time I was able to make out where it is coming from. So this is a cicada which is sucking the sap from the tree and exerting the excess moisture. So what they do is like they suck up a lot of water and they filter out whatever nutrients they want, and the excess water is thrown out from the rear end. It's more like peeing. But the process is very fast. It's instant. Like they suck in, they throw out, they suck in, they throw out. You will be amazed. A tiny cicada of 1-1.5 inch would wet almost like a 6x6 floor. That's how much water it will exert at one go. I have seen them doing it, like my diffuser was wet at that time. So if you are underneath especially during summers, if you are underneath a tree in the jungle and you feel some sparkle of water falling on you, then I'm pretty sure it should be a cicada. It's not rain, and it's not harmful in which way.
Okay.
This is a blue banded bee resting. So what they do is like when they are solitary bees, they just cling on to a stick. This is called a mandible. They cling on to a stick and they just rest. This I was able to shoot when it was resting. This is in the night. So you see them sometimes a lot of them rest together. At times there will be one or two maximum, not more than. This is a longhorn beetle. Compound eyes of a longhorn beetle.
Okay.
This is the blue banded bee I was telling. So,
yeah.
Diffuser, you can use it in different ways to get a focus of the light in a different way. So what I've done is I've just tilted my camera to the left and the light is falling from that side. So you can create some dramatic light accordingly if the subject is cooperative. So you can do that in a lot of subjects. This is a leaf mimic grasshopper. This is mating. This is a female. The bigger one is a female. The male is right here. So the texture on their body is exactly like a leaf, and these dry spots, what you see, they gradually change according to the leaf. If the leaf and dries out, they will also have spots on their bodies.
Okay.
This again, as I told, this is a grasshopper feeding on a cricket. This is again, I have tilted my camera to the left, and the diffused light is falling from one angle. It looks like there is a light source from somewhere else.
Yeah.
So this is just a on-camera flash. You just have to tilt it accordingly, and you can make some dramatic lighting accordingly.
Okay.
This is again a lanternfly. This is again from Agumbe. Very bright colored and a huge lanternfly. This should be more than 2 inches long.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a scale of a beetle.
Okay.
So this is during the rainy day. I'll show you the beetle. This is the beetle. I've just gone to the side and clicked this side of the beetle. So this was on a leaf. It had rained and I was walking. This shined back from my head torch. So I went inspecting. This is a huge beetle. These are like big, almost 3 inch, 2.5 inch. And when you hit flash on their scales, they give out more vibrant colors than what actually you can see in your naked eyes. That is just light passing through different segments of the beetle's shell, and there is a lot of science happening there. So the light diffracts inside and comes out, and your camera picks up more vibrant colors compared to what you can actually see there. So this is nothing like, I have not done anything in Photoshop. So this is how the beetle looks. When you go close up and shoot, it looks completely vibrant. Reds look more red, and greens are all shinier, and it diffuses light again. This is with an inbuilt flash. If I had an external flash, I would have got a better output, I guess.
So we just got a message saying that that was a praying mantis, not a grasshopper. I think the previous...
This one?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I told praying mantis feeding on a grasshopper, so...
Yeah. Just wanted to clear that to him.
Yeah. This is a praying mantis feeding on a grasshopper. That's what I told him. Yeah. Okay, thanks. And this is a leaf insect. These are not common in the part where I stay, so very tough to spot. So they have exact texture matching the trees they are leaving. They are usually found in wild jamun trees and guava trees. So this is one more of it. This is a male which was resting under the leaf. So a friend of mine gave a light from the torch, and this is what I was able to get. And this is how a leaf insect looks. This is on a guava tree. This is a female here. So this is a large female. So they blend in well in their background. Like the guava leaf and the texture on their body is like exactly the same. This is a ledra. This is a nymph of it. They are like almost transparent, and they lay flat in between the leaves. So very tough to spot. These are very tiny again, less than an inch for sure. And you can literally see through them. Like you can't see any parts of it. And they grow up to be huge compared to what the nymph is. They will be almost like 2-3 inches long. And they grow up in a way like they almost blend into the leaf or leaf color, anything as such. So some of them change different colors altogether. Nymphs all look similar to this. This is a praying mantis again. So this was shot when it was raining heavily outside. So I saw this mantis coming in the night. It was feeding on a moth. All these scaly parts what you see on their face is him feeding on a moth. I took a photo. It was in the daytime when I saw it, sorry. So I took a photograph of it the evening. And gradually, when it was totally dark, the eye color changed altogether. So the receptors at the back end of their eyes open up more, and the eye color becomes dark. This was an Indian flower mantis. You get to see them in the regular green color mantises also. They turn black altogether.
That's something so interesting, the eye color.
Yeah, they change accordingly to let more light in and to avoid more light. So
Okay.
daytime they are white, night they are
Yeah.
more darker.
Okay.
This is again a moss mantis, which is another rarity in Agumbe. They'll sit on the moss like this, and at times it's very difficult to spot them. So they have exact patterns on their body which matches the moss around them. And this is an adult, so even the legs, and they have few appendages which matches exactly the moss around. So it's difficult unless the only giveaway is the antenna. When you shine light on them, the antenna starts vibrating rapidly. So I get to see them in one particular species of moss, not in all type of moss. So nymphs are pretty easy to spot. They are there for a longer period of time at one spot. Adults are pretty rare.
Okay.
So this, I used a torch to shoot it. I asked a friend to keep a backlight. And I wanted to show the habitat of it, what exactly it is. So they are usually seen in the night. Daytime, they just go inside the moss and rest probably. I have not seen them much in the daytime.
Okay.
This is a spider wasp. It has paralyzed a spider, and I was photographing it, and one of my fellow photographer also wanted to photograph. So when he rushed in, it flew away. So in a fluke, I got this image. So it was not like planned or anything as such.
Okay.
I just wanted to. So what they do is like they paralyze a spider. If in case they are heavy, they will try to go as higher as possible to take off from there. So I was following it from the ground. So it came to like 2-3 feet, and we were photographing. And usually what happens when you see a subject like this, there will be a rush to photograph. So
yeah.
A friend of mine was there, so not many guests around. So we just had ventured out to photograph a few things, and we got this. And they were able to photograph, but I was the only one to get it in action. Like that motion blur will show that how it has been taking off. And this one again, this was from my kit lens. It was long time back. So what I used to do is like my 1855 lens coupled with Raynox used to give me good results. So if you look at the eyes of it, this is inbuilt flash, that same diffuser what I showed, it is shot from that. So this is a forest lizard, baby forest lizard. And you can pretty much make good images from kit lens. I would suggest, if in case you have any macro adapter, even a cheaper one will do. You can try using it, and it need not that all your images should be sharp from day one. You gradually get used to it and go stage by stage. So probably when you are okay with that, then it's a good time for you to invest into a macro lens. And macro lens, the sharpness in it, true macro lens is something altogether a different thing.
So in fact, one of our viewer, Udit Patak, he even asked, "Hello, sir, how do you suggest reverse lens and extension tubes?"
I personally have never used both of them. Reverse lens, I did use a couple of time, but a lot of difficulty in doing that. So you have to get used to it. I have seen some people making some brilliant images with reverse lens, and even with extension tube, I have no experience with it, because I am pretty much okay doing what I'm doing with my macro lens. So if in case I need more magnification, see those, at that time when I had only kit lens, I got a Raynox. So that was giving me enough results, and I used to borrow lenses from my friends, and I used to fulfill my macro images, whatever I wanted to shoot. So I have never got into investing into a different reverse lens ring and tubes and other stuff. Tubes, of course, it helps. I have seen people using it with prime lenses. It does give good results. So, but you're very much limited when it comes to tubes. Like, see, autofocus with macro lenses work. Like there is infinite focus. You can focus there, you can focus here. But with tubes, you have very limited focus range. You have to either go close. If in case the subject is big, you will not be able to cover it completely. So you're limited when it comes to extension tips. Maybe probably that's why I've not used it much. Reverse lens, I have never used because, see, I bought my equipment, my own equipment, like 4 years back. Before that, I used to borrow others' equipment. So I never was adventurous enough to try reverse mount because that's almost like letting in dust and other stuff inside directly. So I never tried that. This is a freshwater jellyfish. This is again from the backwaters of Mani in Agumbe. So this you get to see in the backwaters when the temperature turns from cold to hot in between that end of year or starting of the year. So they congregate there to breed. So you see millions of them around. These are like 1 inch. What I did here is like I put a black cloth under the water. I took a torch. I asked a friend of mine to give a light from the underneath of it. From top, I have clicked it. So I was with Photoshop. I have increased the black, so that gave me this result. This is a freshwater jellyfish. This is again a rarity there. You don't get to see freshwater jellyfish much.
Okay.
This is entomopathogenic fungi. These are called zombie fungi again. So zombie fungi, when I say, it applies more to ants. What they do is like they, say for example, one ant is dead or a spider is dead. How fungus regenerate is like they release spores in the air. So that spore goes and lands on something else which is living. Say for example, an ant which has been killed by an entomopathogenic fungi will always make sure it dies somewhere around the colony. So when it sporulates, the spores go and land on top of the other ants and the cycle continues. So it again comes. In case of ants, why they call it zombie fungi is because some studies suggest they control the body movement and control the movement of it in such a way that it makes sure it goes to a certain height and die at a place where it's right above the colony, not beyond that. So that next when it sporulates, the fungi sporulates, it makes sure that the whole spores land down. So they're very interesting. These entomopathogenic fungi, they kill large types of hosts, spiders. This is a plant hopper. So I have documented flies, beetles, and whatnot, like even cicadas and other stuff. This is a bioluminescent fungi. What I had photographed them, these are pretty tiny, like 3 mm, 4 mm, that wide, that's it. So what I've done here is I mounted the camera on a tripod. This is a 30 second exposure. So matchstick, after the matchstick is like off and the light ember is around, so long exposure, with the dark background it was looking good, but I wanted something else in the background. So what I did is like I lit a matchstick, put it off, and that ember I did a light painting behind it. So this is what I got finally.
That's great.
These are slime molds, one more interesting creatures. So these are on a dead bark. So usually you find them underneath a dead bark where they will be growing around. These are a colony of it where they have come together to find food. So they come in different colors altogether, the yellow, orange, white, and they are pretty much there during most of the time when it switches from monsoon to winter. So winter and summer is when you find in the damp areas. So we'll come to snakes. This is a green vine snake feeding on a bush frog. So this was late in the night. What I've done here is like, again, I've tilted my camera to the right side and I've shot. That's why I don't see any catch light on the eye. So I've shot it in F18. F16 is what I would recommend you to shoot. I always make sure I don't overexpose the photographs. So I always underexpose at least half a stop so that colors can be recovered. If you overexpose, all these brighter spots you see, it will all be washed out. You'll not be able to recover them. You'd need a lot of work in Photoshop to recover them. So I underexpose and fill in the shadows during post process, so that it gives me an even light. So any lighter subjects for that matter, I would suggest you underexpose it a bit. And
okay.
The challenge of shooting macro in the daytime especially, you will be in the sunlight, you will be shooting, you will think there is enough light looking at the LCD. So what happens is, once you get used to your equipment, say for example your camera LCD brightness, when you come back home and you put it in your system and start processing them, you will get to know how much light was there that day. So initially, for somebody who's starting, I would suggest them to shoot and come back and process the same day if possible, so that you will have a knowledge of what exactly happened while shooting and what is the result you have got. So gradually you'll get used to your equipment, how it performs. When you see it in the LCD, you will gradually realize like what exactly that photo might look in my monitor and how much of things can be recovered. Say for example, if in case it's overexposed or it is underexposed, whether I will be able to recover it or not. That again depends on the equipments they are using, but underexposing any brighter subjects, like lighter subjects, is suggested because you can recover a lot of color back.
Okay. And what about the noise, especially when you're shooting in the rainforest and all? There happen to be a lot of grains in the picture.
Grains, yes. As I told, I don't shoot beyond 200 ISO or 100 at times. Now I have switched to 100. So I increase the intensity of my flash if needed. Because it's a pain removing noise from the background, especially these kind of scenarios when the leaf is quite far, there is a bit of light which has fallen on it. So you still see fringes around. So those fringes are still there. You can't avoid those things, but the noise definitely you can avoid if in case you're shooting in very less ISO.
Okay.
So I would suggest, even if you have a full frame body, don't go beyond 200. Let the flash do its job, increase the intensity. You can pop in more batteries if required. But a noisy image, at times for few images, noise is good. It does look good. But most of the scenarios, people do try to avoid the noise. So
increasing the light intensity doesn't harm the subjects or anything, right?
Not much, because most of my pictures, as you see here, it's a diffused light, so it's more even.
Okay.
And harming, not harming, it's up to you, like how many shots you take, what kind of disturbance you are doing it to the subject.
Yeah.
And I take people out, so I see a lot of time when something like this one was very cooperative. It was feeding all by itself. We shot a couple of photos, we give it some time, then the next guy goes, we 2-3 photos, then come back. What I do is, like, I will ask them to set the settings, what exactly, like I will see into that exact moment, what exactly, the where exactly the subject is, and I will ask them to just shoot some random subject which looks exactly like that. If they feel the lighting is correct, then go ahead and shoot it. Don't go there to the subject and change the settings and trial and error, especially during times when something like this is happening, when it is feeding or anything. So it will be there, it will feed for a certain time, it will be there for 3-4 minutes at least. So you have enough time, you try set it and then go close as much as possible. Make sure your focus is where you exactly want it, just click, come back, and I would suggest them to shoot as far as possible so that they can crop and reframe however they want the images to be.
Okay.
This is a bamboo pit viper. This is outside of Bangalore near Kolar. We found a few days back.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see the catch light here. These are all from the diffuser.
Okay.
This is a Malabar pit viper feeding on a gliding frog. This is an old image. I was lucky to witness this whole hunt sequence. I do have a video. I don't think I have it right now handy. Where it caught the gliding frog, I mean the whole action. I had only one guest along with me, so it was not crowded, So we were able to spend quite a lot of time with it and photograph it. It
Okay.
didn't take much time because, as you know, that this Pit Viper was quite large. So even the gliding frog gave a good fight, but two, three times it chewed and ejected the venom, and the gliding frog was dead. So it ate up instantly. It took it like hardly 1, 1.5 minute maximum to completely swallow it. So what they do is like they have two fangs, they work it around. So it's more like they pierce it, pull it in, pierce it, pull it in. So it's nice action to see. It's a pit viper. This was in our homestay where we store dry wood. So
Okay.
it had to be relocated. So I went a bit closer. The diffuser is quite large, so it gives you a shield in front. So I tried photographing it before releasing it.
Okay. We have a comment from Angad. Angad
Yeah,
is still
yes.
waiting for yellow
He's been waiting. He's been waiting from quite a long time now. He somehow managed to see the orange. Orange was his target. Now he's switched to yellow. Let's hope I can show it next time. See you there. See you in Ingara then. Oh, this is again the same thing. It's from back a bit. So this is a different thing. Like you will, if you spend enough time looking into green vine, at some places where the human habitation is, if you see, if you have a fence running around the edge of the jungle, you'll always find green vines around there. So
Okay.
green vines are not that rare at times, especially during monsoon to see them. They're there. Like there are times I would have seen the same individual at around the same spot for like almost a month, and I have seen them courting. So feeding is one thing where you will instantly get to know. I've seen them quite a few time, and many of our guests have seen a live hunt also. So they just are focused on the prey, and no matter who walks around them, they will not even bother to look at them. So you know that it will hunt. How long it will take is nobody's guess, because there are times you would have spent half a day looking into it, and it would fail finally when it stuck. And at times, like just 10 minutes into it, they will strike, they will catch something. And there are times they will catch such tiny prey, you will not even know what exactly they have caught. They will just catch, swallow it, and then come up. So
Okay.
this is one such time. A friend of mine had come down just to photograph green vines. So he was sitting and observing this green vine. He actually saw, he called us, and I was also able to make some images of it. This is where I've used a fill flash. I have not completely used the intensity of the flash to light the subject. This is just a tiny amount of flash and the ambient light in the background for the bokeh. So I don't do much of these kind of photographs, but at times I will try. These are all the different kinds of morphs. So these are from different places altogether: Sharavati, Agumbe, yeah, those two places. So Malabar pit vipers come in many different colors. Orange and yellow is what they say it's rare, and people want to see them more. So green and brown are the most common colors. This is the drier variant of it. Yellow and brown. So there are more colors. There are more colors. These are few which I have seen. This is a Melanopidium. It's a shield tail. We found it in the plantation. So these are burrowing snakes. They have some excellent shiny scales in them. So each curve will give out some vibrant blue sheen when you hit flash on them. And even when you see them sitting, it's like amazing. This is the whole photo of it. This is the most colorful snake, and the beautiful and the rarest snake I've seen till date. So this is again one more instance when I saw a. So where I work, we have a small pond. We have created a pond where gliding frogs and other frogs breed. So it's a hub, hot hub for snakes. So in the peak monsoon, there are times you have seen close to 6 pit vipers. There were like a lot of people, like at least 10 guests of ours, each coming up and telling, "I have seen a pit viper here, there." In the space is hardly like 100 feet across. So if you sit and observe, you will definitely see some action. So not always, but very rare. So I happened to walk into this scene. So this guy was holding on to it, and the gliding frog was not giving up easily. It held on to that for quite a some time, like almost 5 6 minutes, and then later when the grips were all lost, it was dead, and this guy swallowed, and he sat there coiled up for the whole night. This is a chameleon tail. We found a chameleon recently, outskirts of Bangalore. It's called Kanakpura. So on the main road we were going, and road edge, we were able to spot one chameleon. So very beautiful creature. This is the only time I've seen it. This was recent April. And this photo is from a wide angle lens. It's 1635. It's a non-macro lens. Since the subject was quite big, I was able to create that. I just wanted some wide angle kind of a thing, but this didn't had a very close focusing thing. So I just clicked from wherever it can focus and cropped it a bit. So this looks like I shot it in some wide angle macro or anything, but it's just 1835 wide angle, that landscape lens what people use for. This is again gecko, from the drier parts, again from Kolar. It's called reticulated gecko. It's a close up, like I've not gone this close, I've cropped the image closer. So you can see the catch light here. You can see my Raynox and the diffuser. Let's go to spiders now. This is a crab spider. So these are bomus, a male on top and a female in the bottom. So this was long back when I first bought my macro lens, and this was almost like the first set of images from Raynox and my new macro lens. I was still figuring out how to focus and how to light the subject and stuff. So somehow managed to get some. These are pretty tiny. These are very very tiny spiders, 4 5 mm, not bigger than that. So spiders, most of the males are smaller, females are the bigger ones. And this guy clings on to the female. At times she won't accept him, and it takes time for him to mate with her, sometimes days altogether. This is again on a snakeweed plant. This is a crab spider, which has hunted down a blue-banded bee. So I like the color contrast. It was there. A friend of mine called up. He told, "It's right in front. Come if you want to shoot." So I went with my gear. So it sat like that for quite a some time, like almost for an hour at least. So we were able to make some good images. So the thing with the lighter subjects, again, light colored ones, very tough to balance the exposure. So I did underexpose a bit, but still some of the colors here are washed out. I still not was able to get back the details on the overexposed part. This is a bomus, bolas, sorry, bola spider. So this has a very unique hunting technique. What it does is it takes a long web, creates 3 4 drops of sticky blobs, and it rotates and throws it on the prey. Most of the time it hunts only moths. What it does is, like, it creates a female pheromone of the moth, and whenever that pheromone attracts the male moths towards it, and whenever something flies towards it, it rotates and throws it on it. These sticky blobs go and get stuck to the moth, pull it up, wrap it around with the web, and keep it aside. For the whole night she will hunt. Midnight, around midnight, it will feed, and it will throw down the rest of it. So most of the time they usually prey on one particular species of moth, because they will be emitting one particular species female pheromones. This is a twig mimic spider. This is a kill. It has wrapped it around and it's holding on to it. Again, just with the diffuser. My diffuser is shorter, so I'm able to approach close to the web. So,
Okay.
underpart, you can always light it up. You can have a small card, white card, held on to it. So, when the light falls on it, it gives a light from the bottom as well, so that you avoid shadows if in case you're shooting from a diffuser. Wolf spider. This is a netcaster. Just a minute. Yeah, this is a netcasting spider. So very unique hunting strategies for it. What it does is like it spins a web. It's more like a fisherman's net where he casts to catch the fish. So they cling upside down, facing a tree or a bark or anything as such, where it might find something walking around. As soon as it finds something walking around, it just throws out those web on it, wrap it around and feed on it. So these are nocturnal. That's why they have these two huge eyes. They have more eyes here, but these two are their primary eyes from which they see. They have excellent vision. So very unique way of hunting I have seen. Again, a wolf spider. Close up. This is a huntsman which has taken down a froglet. So spiders, again, especially these kind of big spiders, they are very opportunistic. They feed on anything and everything they can get their hands on to. So this one was missing two legs on the right side, but somehow still manages to catch a bullfrog, baby bullfrog, and feed on it. They are known to catch geckos, frogs, whatnot. Like this was on the ground, so if in case they are on a tree or somewhere, they will. We don't know. Like very less is known about prey of spiders exactly. So whatever we have seen is what we know. That's it. Every time somebody posts something new, something new kind of a prey it's been eating, it's like a first thing for everybody. Recently, a lot of people have taken up a lot of interest in spiders. Very good to see a lot of enthusiasts, especially like me, and many hobbyists who are excellent when it comes to hiding spiders. And many are doing it in their backyards, many are doing it in their homes, especially in the urban areas as well. So there are a lot of new spiders being described, and new behaviors being observed by normal citizens who are just hobbyists. So very, very macro is something which is gradually building up, especially during this COVID time. People can't go out, so they try spending their time in their gardens or inside the house, or whatever tiny stuff they see, they try to photograph. And a lot of people keep sending photographs, asking for IDs, and a lot of photos I see online. So it's a good thing happening. So we are getting to know a lot of things about creatures which we never know much about. So this is again a hillus jumper. It's inside nest. So it's a dry leaf. It has rolled it up and built a nest with this web. It's again a jumping spider. Close up of the eyes. So these are heavily cropped because the closer you go, you won't be able to get this much of focus. So I try to focus from as maximum distance I can and then crop the images accordingly. This is an ant mimic spider. This is a male, this is a female. So females are closer to what ants look like. Males have this huge palps so that they don't look much like an ant. So what they do is, like, while walking around, the front two legs, usually, spiders have four legs, So ants have six. So what they do is, like, the front two legs, they will mimic them as an antenna and walk around. So
okay,
they're right in, I mean, the ant looks exactly like this, like the female here. So no difference as such, except you can make out in closer thing that there are eight eyes here. So so they blend in, they sometime hunt them down, few of them steal pupas of it and whatnot. Like, that this is extreme mimicry of and they have evolved in such a way to mimic their prey, get in between them and hunt them down. Sometimes it gives them protection as well. Most of the time, few of the spiders evolve in such a way to mimic something to avoid predation. So that, say for example, ants and all, not many eat ants because they are not tasty. So evolving in such a way will help them to survive longer.
Okay.
So this is a huntsman spider, lichen huntsman we call it. So this is completely blended into the lichens on the tree. So if you can see the back abdomen, two legs,
yeah,
and two more pairs in the front, eyes here. So they have this outgrowth of hairs which will help them like flatten themselves on top of a tree. So this was on a big tree, so very difficult to look at them until unless you have an head torch where you look from far and you get some sort of eye shine back, and when you go close and examine, you get to see this. That's how I spotted this one. It's very difficult unless they don't move, you will not be able to make them out much.
Mm-hmm.
This is again a jumping spider. This is a Telemonia, one of the most common spiders.
You
can see here it was resting on a leaf. I'm holding on to the leaf in my one of my hand, and there are some leaf in between my diffuser, so I was able to. I'm quite far, so this is a heavily cropped image. So I think that's it from my end. So
okay.
Yes.
That was an amazing session, I should say. Like, lot of species I've seen today, and many of us. So
yeah, I mean, yeah. Macro is something, it's there, but
we need to look for it. Yeah.
Yeah.
We have lot of comments and lot of questions as well.
Yes.
Let me go one by one. I'm not reading the comments. I'm just going through.
Sure.
Rupsana Pradhan is asking, sir, what tips would you give for a macro photography with mobile phones?
Mobile phones, okay. So that's a different
category. Yeah.
So one good macro adopter for sure, because you can't, I mean, there are cameras with dedicated macro lens in the inbuilt, but they're not that great. So any clip-on macro lens onto your primary camera, and some good lighting. Today you get diffusers for mobile macro lens, where it's just small box on both the sides with LEDs into it. Look for it, you'll get it. It can be clipped on along with the clip-on lens. You'll have two lights, and with the primary lens, I'm pretty sure there are so many in my Instagram profile who do some amazing mobile macro photography. At times we feel like we carry this bulky cameras into the places where we want to photograph, and these guys are coming up with some amazing images with just their mobile phone and one macro adapter. So one macro adapter for sure is required, and get to know about the limitations of your phone. Not all phones can perform the same, not all output are same. Images need not to be pitch crisp sharp, so you don't have to over sharpen them. Even with less sharpening, if in the case the overall images look good, if you get a good bokeh, then that image is good, definitely.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Does using the lens with APS-C sensor helps in magnification?
It does a bit, not much though. So
Okay.
that again depends on what kind of camera you're using, and so many factors into it. You can't just say like a crop sensor will give you more depth or anything as such. So it all depends on what setting you're shooting, what kind of scenario you're in, what kind of a subject you're shooting, lighting. So many other factors. But yeah, I mean, full frame has its own advantage, like noise reduction, and some full frames come with lot of megapixels where you can crop in more and get more details out of it. So it's a subjective thing, like you can't really judge accordingly.
Okay. Can we use extension tube plus Raynox?
Yeah, that would be too much of magnification to shoot handheld. The depth of field will be very shallow, and I don't recommend doing that, because Raynox into itself is more than enough, and if you are shooting with extension tube, that is more magnification than Raynox, so that should be more than enough for you.
Okay. How to achieve focus manually?
Manually, I would suggest, depends on the subject again. You fix it to 1:1 in your lens. I mean, manually, when you say when they're shooting, or yeah, I think so, that's what they meant.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
turn it to 1:1, go close. Yeah, again, it needs some getting used to. You go close, you find the focus, and you release the shutter. So that you have to get used to it. So autofocus is when we just press the button and get the focus and shoot. Manual, again, it's a different ball game altogether. You have to get used to that kind of a scenario. So you have to manually, gradually you'll get to know, as and when you shoot different kind of subject, different size of subjects, you will know how much magnification you need. Accordingly, you set your lens focus and go close and come far depending on your need.
Okay. We have a question from Dr. K.M. Anand. Do you use AFC or AFS? What focusing points?
One single focus point, always in the center. I don't move them around. Even, I mean, if somebody is using Raynox, make sure you use only center autofocus, because anywhere here and there, the subject may not be in focus. I mean, not sharp though. I always use center focus point. I will always crop the image accordingly if I want to reframe it. And I use single point of focus. I don't use continuous autofocus mode.
So AFS.
AFS, yes.
Okay. Two common types to increase magnification with macro lens is usage Raynox versus extension tubes. Which one would you suggest and why?
Raynox, it's versatile. Raynox is just a clip-on lens. So when you put extension tube, as I told earlier, you are limited. And removing and putting back the macro lens or whatever lens you are using, that's a hassle, especially when you are on field photographing something. Raynox is pretty easy. You just press two things, mount it on the lens. When you don't want, you just remove and put it in your pocket. So I would still suggest invest in Raynox if in case you are a photographer who goes around looking for subject and shoot. If you are somebody who want to explore something with a setup kind of a thing, then you can definitely try extension tubes. I don't have much of experience into it, so I don't want to comment much on it.
Vishwanath Gowda is asking, needed clarity in using multi-point and single point focus in macro.
I would suggest go with single point. Multi-point, I don't use it. Most of them don't use, because one point of focus and your aperture is so like you shoot at f16, f13 at times. So gradually, as in when you shoot, you will know how much of things are in focus, where exactly your focus is. So you don't need multiple focus points. So one single point of focus, that's always center, I would suggest. And you shoot from, you give some breathing space across the frame, and then you crop it however you want to and reframe the.
Okay. And what software do you use to process the images?
I use Adobe Photoshop, not Explore Lightroom. Photoshop I use.
And what are the main things that you edit?
Oh, okay. So most of the work I do it in Camera Raw only. So majorly what I do is like shadow correction. That's one thing I always make sure. I always underexpose. I reduce the contrast a bit in my images, and then
Okay.
I reduce highlight. I increase the shadows, and then I come to colors. So Nikon, if you're shooting green, all of us know it's oversaturated a bit at times. So first, if in case it's green, I reduce whatever colors I feel I'm seeing more, and color temperature is one thing I always look for. Like in the drawer there, in the camera raw only, I will adjust the thing, and then I will open Photoshop, and probably I use at times I use the highlight and shadow tool most of the time, if in case the subject is well lit and there is some bit of shadow in it. Every time I use it, I always make sure I reduce the contrast a bit, because highlight and shadow tool somehow adds on to the contrast a bit. So I don't over sharpen my images. I always make sure it's pleasing. Most of them, the tendency initially when you start is to increase the contrast and increase the sharpness. So when you do that, your images will look crispier, but overall, for social media consumption, it might not look that great. So you need to find that small balance where you feel like you have enough sharpness in your image. Not so much that it looks artificial at times, not so less that it's not appealing to whoever is watching it. So contrast, reducing contrast helps me achieve that a bit at times. As I told, temperature correction and color correction is one thing I do a lot, and shadow correction most of the time.
Chandra Prasad is asking, Raynox DCR250, is it compatible with 100 mm macro lenses or kit lenses?
It is compatible with anything from 56 mm to 67 mm. So it's more like a compression clip, which goes and clings on to your thread, which is there for your filters. So it varies. It has a variable of fitting length. So most of the kit lens it fits, and almost all of the macro lenses these days it fits.
Bhavna Sharma is asking, the diffuser that you make, is it available for purchase?
Yeah, I do sell them. It's called Radiant Diffuser. So I do sell them across. So if somebody wants, you can get in touch with
Contact.
me.
Sahil Solkar is asking, hi, which equipments have you do you have in your camera bag?
So I shoot only macro. I don't even have a kit lens. I have a 5100 Nikon D5100, the tiny body. I have a Tamron 90 mm, the latest version SP lens, and I have a Raynox. I have a Yongnuo manual flash, which fits into all the bodies, and one diffuser I carry everywhere. And recently, I got a remote trigger cable for flash, so that's the latest addition. So all the images of Chameleon, that one wide-angle image was shot with that.
Anil Kulkarni is asking, how could you get black background?
So when you're shooting in F16, F13, and you're using artificial light, especially flash, so what happens is, like, that's a very narrow passage for light to pass through. So whatever initially light hits onto, that's the only thing camera will capture. So automatically, when you're shooting with artificial light at that kind of setting, so you tend to get more of a darker background. So I choose, most of the time I choose darker backgrounds to isolate my subject. So when you look through the viewfinder, there will always be somewhere or the other where the background will be darker. So especially if you're shooting in the night time, most of my photos are all the nocturnal species. Daytime, when I'm shooting, I make sure I place myself accordingly so that I get some dark. There were so many images of mine where there was still some bit of background visible, very faintly and all. So it's not always the case, but most of the time it does. So F16, F13, with that intensity of flash, it definitely gives that kind of a background for sure.
Okay. Edmondosa, hi from Mexico. What is your lighting setup, Girish?
Yeah, as I told, I make a diffuser of my own. It's called Radiant Diffuser. So, and an external flash. So it's always mounted on my camera. That's it.
Yeah, I think we have in the flash mode, TTL mode or manual mode? Which
manual.
One?
See, macro is manual everywhere. So I use a manual flash, and whoever has a TTL, I always make sure I ask them to switch it to manual mode, because you have the control. TTL is like, it gives out its own strength of light, whatever it calculates accordingly. Most of the time people will be using flash, especially for tinier macros with diffuser. So there is one more layer of it which the flash through the lens can't calculate. So I would always suggest people to shoot with manual. And manual, you have complete control over it. Like 1/16 is the standard. I'll ask somebody to start with, if in case you are using a diffuser. Accordingly, you reduce, your intensity will increase. You increase, your intensity will be, I mean, the output will be reduced. So manual mode always.
Yeah, great. And Rhinox 250 or 350, which one do you recommend?
350. I'm not sure if there is a 350. There was 150 and there was 250. And recently there are three, four of super magnifying adapters which has come out. Those are very tough to do handheld. So Rhinox DCR 250 is the most standard one used across the world right now. So I would suggest you go ahead with that. Due to lockdown, the availability has like come. I mean, it's very difficult now to get it. If in case somebody is coming from outside, I got it for 3,800 rupees from Indonesia. So US and all, it's around 4,000. In India, it's close to 7,000 rupees. So there is a lot of difference in price.
One question from Manjunath Acharya. How you handle the subjects? Because most of the time, macro subjects are hiding in the bushes and sometimes under the rocks.
Yeah. I mean, most of the time, yes. I stay in Agumbe. So for me, opportunity is always there. So I do miss at times. See, spiders especially. If you are slow enough, if you're careful enough, you can definitely hold the whole branch or something where they're sitting, and accordingly you go around, or you can just bend the stick around and shoot them. So it's all about getting used to the subjects. Like most of the time you will be able to the last image I showed of a spider, so I tried like at least 10 times photographing it. It turned that side, this side. So what I usually do is, like, I always keep my camera in front of it. I move around. I don't pick out my camera if in case there is a spider or anything there. So every time I have to do something, camera stays at their place, and I do, and I go back again, and then I shoot. So you avoid moving a lot around in front of them, and no sudden movements usually, especially with tinier subjects. So the slower you approach, the calmer they will stay. It's not guaranteed, but for me, I mean, I stay in a place with so much of opportunity around. So people ask me, like, how do you get to see that, this and all? I say, like, throughout the year I stay there. So you would have come visited me once, and you would have not seen certain things. You are not able to photograph. Like that, I would have missed it 100 times. I would have succeeded in 101 first time or something like that. So in my case, I mean, at times lucky, at times persistent, at times some sort of getting used to the subject.
Yeah, I think we have covered almost all the questions. Thank you, Girish. That was an amazing session.
Thank you so much.
Lot of knowledge sharing. It helped us a lot.
Thanks for the opportunity.
I hope we will have one more session soon with a lot of new images.
Sure, definitely. Hopefully, the COVID goes away fast and everybody can explore and photograph more during this monsoon.
Anybody who want to explore more of Western Ghats, especially Agumbe, they can contact Girish and he will help you. Yeah, sure.
Yes.
Even once everything is ready, like the COVID situation is little down, we'll also plan one trip. We'll meet for
definitely.
Sure. Yeah.
Please come down.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Thank you again. Thank you so much.
Stay safe.
You too.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks. Bye. Good night.
Bye. Good night. Yeah, so that was Girish Kavada. Excellent presentation, lot of knowledge and wonderful images from the Western Ghats. Macro is a very good subject to photograph without spending so much as well. So anybody can do it in your backyard as well. And if somebody want to explore it, especially Agumbe, you can always connect with Girish. He will help you. So that's it for the day. May 3rd, we'll be having one more session. I will inform who is it, our new guest. So wait for that. Mostly by tomorrow, we'll update you. And everyone, take care. It's COVID everywhere. So please take care of yourself. And see you soon. Thank you again.